Welcome, everyone. We're delighted to have you here. We've got a full house for a wonderful talk tonight. And I won't spend too much time up here, but I do just want to let you know that we have one more somewhat Alice-related event tomorrow night, if you're still in town. We have Jim Gardner, the son of Martin Gardner, who will be talking about what it was like growing up with Martin. And you may hear a little bit about the relationship between Martin and Alice in Wonderland. So we encourage you to go to our website and sign up for that if you haven't already. And with that, let me tell you who will be introducing tonight's presentation. We have a distinguished professor of history and the science of history, Joe Dauben, from the City University of New York. I give you Joe.
Thank you, Cindy. Well, I've been asked to introduce Robin Wilson, and it's a pleasure to do so, because I know he's well known to many of you in the audience this evening. But for those of you who don't know Robin Wilson, let me just say that he began his career as a mathematician with a BA, taking first-class honors in mathematics at Balliol College, Oxford. He then came to this country to do his MA and his PhD at the University of Pennsylvania, writing his doctoral thesis on number theory. And he spent 1967-68 as a research fellow at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. So he knows the United States quite well. In fact, he told me over lunch today that he has been to 49 of the 50 states, something I can't say that I've managed to do. But he's now emeritus professor in pure mathematics in the Faculty of Mathematics, Computing, and Technology at the Open University. He retired from Open University in England in 2009. But previously, he was the head of the pure mathematics department and formerly a dean of the faculty. His main areas of research interest are graph theory, in particular graph colorings and especially edge colorings. He has a specific interest that many of you are familiar with in the history of mathematics, particularly British history from 1600 on, particularly the period from 1840 to 1940, and the history of Gresham College. And in fact, he's also an emeritus professor of Gresham College in London. And there he's given lectures to the general public, and those lectures are actually available on the Gresham College website. He's also a former fellow of in mathematics at Keble College, Oxford, and is a part-time fellow at Pembroke College, Oxford as well. He's also an immediate past president of the British Society for the History of Mathematics. Now, he also has written well in excess of 30 books. His earliest book, I think, is on graph theory from 1736 to 1936. It's still a standard work in print. His introduction to graph theory, published in 1972 maybe. Anyway, it's sold over 50,000 copies. His book, How to Solve Sudoku, has sold over 200,000 copies. Of his papers, my favorite is on the chromatic index of almost all graphs, which has given him an Erdős number of 1, for those of you who know about Erdős numbers. His paper, An Invitation to Matroid Theory, won the Lester Ford Award of the Mathematical Association of America in 1975 for outstanding expository writing. His paper, The Truth About Königsberg, won the Polya Prize in 2005 from the Mathematical Association of America. And tonight, Robin Wilson is here to autograph his book, which will be on sale after this evening's presentation, so keep that in mind. This is published in England by Penguin and here by Norton in the United States. And actually, I've been speaking about Robin as if he were actually present, but I only learned this morning that he can't be here this evening. And so thanks to the magic of the Mathematics Museum and time travel, we've got a replacement, and that is Charles Dodgson. So without further delay, Professor Dodgson.
Good evening, everybody. Here's a letter I wrote in verse to my friend Margaret Cunningham from Christchurch in Oxford on the 30th of January, 1868. Dear Maggie, no cart has yet been done of me that does real justice to my smile. And so I hardly like, you see, to send you one. Meanwhile, I send you a little thing to give you an idea of what I look like when I'm lecturing. The merest sketch you will allow, yet I still think there's something grand in the expression of the brow and in the action of the hand. Your affectionate friend, C.L. Dodgson. P.S. My best love to yourself, to your mother, my kindest regards, to your small, fat, impertinent, ignorant brother, my hatred. I think that is all. My name is Charles Dodgson, but you probably know me better by my pen name of Lewis Carroll, which I use when writing my books for children, such as Alice's Adventures in Wonderland and Through the Looking Glass. But in fact, I'm mainly a teacher of mathematics, and today I'd like to tell you about some of my mathematical interests with the help of Joseph Dorman, Francine Ablis, and Jennifer Beinecke. On your handout, you'll find some of the mathematical questions and problems that I'll be talking about today, and I hope you'll join with me in answering them as we go. But in any case, you'll certainly find mathematical allusions throughout my works, even in the Alice books. For example, do you remember the mock turtle scene?
We went to school in the sea. The master was an old turtle. We used to call him Tortoise.
Why did you call him Tortoise if he wasn't one?
We called him Tortoise because he taught us. Really, you're very dull. I only took the regular course.
What was that?
Reeling and writhing to begin with, and then the different branches of arithmetic, ambition, distraction, uglification, and derision.
And how many hours a day did you do lessons?
10 hours the first day, 9 hours the next, and so on.
What a curious plan.
Well, that's the reason they're called lessons, because they lessen from day to day.
And in Through the Looking Glass, which is based on a game of chess, the White Queen and Red Queen test Alice to see whether she should become queen.
Can you do addition? What's one and one and one and one and one? One and one and one and one and one?
I don't know. I lost count.
What answer should Alice have given? 10. Very good. Well done.
She can't do addition. Can you do subtraction? Take 9 from 8.
9 from 8? I can't, you know, but...
So what's the answer?
0.
Excellent.
She can't do subtraction. Can you do division? Divide a loaf by a knife. What's the answer to that?
So, what's the answer?
Well, I suppose...
Bread and butter, of course. She can't do sums a bit.
And arithmetical ideas appear in my other children's books, too. In the Hunting of the Snark, the butcher tries to convince the beaver that 2 plus 1 is 3.
Now, 2 added to 1... If that could be done, it said with one's fingers and thumbs, recalling with tears how in earlier years it had taken no pains with its sums. Taking 3 as the subject to reason about, a convenient number to state, we add 7 and 10 and then multiply out by 1,000 diminished by 8. The result we proceed to divide, as you see, by 992, then subtract 17, and the answer must be exactly and perfectly true.
So does this prove that 2 plus 1 equals 3? No, of course not. Whatever number we start with, we always end up with the same number at the end. For a more meaty example, let's go to my last major novel, Sylvie and Bruno Concluded. Lady Muriel is hemming pocket handkerchiefs. Up comes Mein Herr, a German professor, who explains how she can sew 3 of them together to make Fortunatus's purse, which has no outside, and which therefore contains all the fortune of the world inside it. Actually, it has no inside either. Well, to see what's involved, we'll start by making a Möbius band. How many of you in the past have made a Möbius band? Excellent. But if you have never tried it, take a long strip of paper, twist one end through 180 degrees, and then join the ends together, as you can see. The resulting object has only one side, a as you'll see if you follow the ant around the dotted line. Now, here's a thought experiment. If you haven't done this before, try to imagine what would happen if you then cut the Möbius band along this middle dotted line. Try it when you get home. You might be very surprised. So for the next thing, for the bottom diagram, I want you now to try to imagine joining the top edge of the Möbius band to the bottom edge. But I want you to give one of them the edges a 180-degree twist before doing so. If you find that difficult to visualize, that's because it can't actually be done in three dimensions. But the resulting mathematical object is called a projective plane, and it has no inside and no outside. And in my book, Lady Muriel stops her sewing just before the task actually becomes impossible. Mein Herr then moves on to a topic of a more geographical nature.
There's another thing we've learned from your nation, map making. But we've carried it much further than you. What do you consider the largest map that would be really useful?
About 6 inches to the mile.
Only 6 inches? We very soon got to 6 yards to a mile. Then we tried a map with 100 yards to the mile. And then came the greatest idea of all. We actually made a map of the country on the scale of a mile to the mile.
Have you used it much?
Well, it's never really been spread out yet. The farmers objected. They said it would cover the whole country and shut out the sunlight. So now we use the country itself as its own map. And I assure you it does nearly as well.
But I do apologize. It's high time I told you a little about myself. I was born in 1832 into a good English church family in Darsbury in Cheshire, where my father, the Reverend Charles Dodgson, was the incumbent until 1843, when we all moved to Croft Rectory in Yorkshire. There, I and my 3 brothers and my 7 sisters enjoyed a very happy childhood, with lots of games to play, walks to take in the countryside, and puzzles to solve. Here's a very complicated maze I once constructed for my brothers and sisters. Apparently, it was the first ever three-dimensional maze. If you want to try it, it's on the back of your problem sheet. But it's rather difficult, as you can see from the answer. So I'll remove this, and you can try it when you get home. But that was much later. From the start, I was always interested in mathematics, which my father taught me, along with Latin, Christian theology, and English literature. When I was a very small boy, apparently, I went to my father and showed him a book of logarithms with the request, "Please explain."
"You're much too young to understand anything about such a difficult subject."
Apparently, I thought this irrelevant, for I still insisted, "But please explain." I was also fascinated by geometry from an early age. Here's part of a 2-page note on how to divide a right angle into 3 equal parts. I wrote this when I was aged just 12, the age when I also started to compose Latin verse. By this time, my father could afford to send me to school, first to Richmond School in Yorkshire, and then to Rugby School, where I delighted in mathematics and the classics, but disliked much of the rough and tumble of everyday school life. My arithmetic textbook was Francis Walkingame's classic text, and I'm going to show you some questions from it. You'll notice that they are probably not what you'd find in your arithmetic school books today.
What is the cube root of 673,373,097,125?
If 504 Flemish L's, 2 quarters, cost £283.17.06, what must I give for 14 yards?
What sum did that gentleman receive in dowry with his wife, whose fortune was her wedding suit, her petticoat having 2 rows of furbelows, each furbelow 87 quills, and each quill 21 guineas?
And even, would you believe, the Spectators Club of Fat People, though it consisted of 15 members, is said to have weighed no less than 3 tons. How much was that per man? I don't think you'd find that in books today. After finishing at rugby school, I returned home to await entry to Oxford. While there, I made up some puzzles. Here's one of them, which some of you will know. Which is better, a clock that's right only once a year, or a clock that's right twice every day?
Well, the latter, unquestionably.
How many of you agree? How many of you disagree? Well, let's see, very good, now attend. I have 2 clocks. One doesn't go at all, and the other loses a minute a day. Which would you prefer?
The losing one, without a doubt.
Do you agree with that? Now listen, the one that loses a minute a day has to lose 12 hours, or 720 minutes, before it is right again. Consequently, it is only right once in 2 years, whereas the other is right as often as the time it points to comes round, which happens twice a day. So you've contradicted yourself once.
Ah, but what's the use of its being right once a day if I can't tell when the time comes?
Why, suppose the clock points to 8 o'clock. Don't you see that the clock is right at 8 o'clock? Consequently, when 8 o'clock comes, your clock is right.
Yes, I see that.
Very good, then you've contradicted yourself twice.
But how am I to know when 8 o'clock does come? My clock won't tell me.
Be patient. You know that when 8 o'clock comes, your clock is right. Very good. Then your rule is this. Keep your eye fixed on the clock, and the very moment it is right, it'll be 8 o'clock. In May 1850, I applied to Oxford University, where I was examined in Latin, Greek, and mathematics, and was accepted at Christchurch, the largest college where my father had studied some years earlier with great success, and where I was to spend the rest of my life. I took up residence in January 1851 for a 4-year honours degree course in classics and mathematics. My university course consisted mainly of mathematics and classical and biblical texts and involved 3 main examinations, as you can see. Starting in summer 1851 with my responsions exams. Here's a letter I wrote in Oldie Englishy to my sister Louisa.
My beloved and thrice respected sister, Oni Mooney, his day nexty, we go in for e responsions, and I am e uppy to mine eyes in worky. Thine truly, Charles.
My instructions mainly in college with the college lecturer Robert Fawcett, shown above. And I also attended lectures by the professor of geometry, the Reverend Baden Powell, whose son was later to found the Boy Scout movement. My examinations were both written and oral. And as you can see, an Oxford oral exam can be rather terrifying. In the summer of 1854, shortly before my mathematics finals examinations, I went on a reading party to Yorkshire with a professor of natural philosophy, Bartholomew Price. Everyone called him Bat Price, possibly because his lectures were way above the audience. And I remembered him later in the Hatter's parody of Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star.
Twinkle, twinkle, little bat, how I wonder where you're at. You know the song, I suppose.
I've heard something like it.
It goes on, you know, like this. Up above the world you fly, like a tea tray in the sky. Twinkle, twinkle, twinkle.
Incidentally, how many of you have heard of the Mad Hatter? There is no such character. If you look in Alice, you'll find there's a hatter and a mad tea party, but you'll find no Mad Hatter. My finals examinations took place at the end of 1854, and they ranged over all areas of mathematics, including such topics as calculus, gravitation, and optics. So here are a couple of questions from that year from the paper on geometry and algebra. First, let's have a traditional question one on arithmetic.
Compare the advantages of a decimal and of a duodecimal system of notation in reference to one commerce, 2, pure arithmetic, and show by duodecimals that the area of a room whose length is 29 feet, 7 1/2 inches, and breadth is 33 feet, 9 1/4 inches, is 704 feet, 30 3/8 inches.
And now a tricky question 6, on geometry.
In a given equilateral triangle, a circle is inscribed, and then in the triangle, formed by a tangent to that circle, parallel to any side, and the parts of the original triangle cut off by it, another circle is inscribed, and so on ad infinitum. Find the sum of the radii of these circles.
When the results eventually came out, I'd been highly successful, getting the top mathematics degree in the university. As I wrote to my sister Mary,
I have just been to Mr. Price to see how I did in the papers, and the result will, I hope, be gratifying to you.
I then listed those in the first class, concluding,
all this is very satisfactory.
After my finals, I stayed on at Christchurch, earning my keep by private teaching. On the left, you can see the famous entrance, Tom Tower, designed by Christopher Wren. And on the right is the famous dining hall where I dined over 10,000 times, and which, so I'm told, later came to be celebrated as the dining hall of Hogwarts. In that year, 1855, the old dean, the head of college, died and was replaced by a new one, the Reverend Henry Liddell. Half of the team of Liddell and Scott, who compiled the Greek dictionary that's still in use by students even today.
He's the dean, and I'm Mrs. Liddell. I play the first, and he the second fiddle. I'm the broad, and he's the high. We're the universiti. Our family included our young son, Harry, and our three daughters, shown here with Alice on the right. Very different from the image you know from the Alice books.
Meanwhile, Robert Fawcett, the mathematical lecturer, had gone to fight in the Crimean War, and the new dean appointed me in his place. I was to hold this position for 25 years. Around this time, I tried my hand at some teaching in a local school, where I varied my mathematics lessons with stories and puzzles. I've always believed that recreational topics are a useful tool for conveying more serious ideas. Here are a couple of the puzzles that I used. The first one, I'm going to try it in a minute. I'm going to start with the number 1, and then we take it in turns with someone else to add a new number, and that new number must never exceed 10. And the person that reaches 100 is the winner. How can I ensure that I always win? So let's try this. Are there any volunteers? Would you like to come up? What's your name?
Anna.
I'm going to play this game with Anna. So I'm going to start with 1, and then Anna must add any number, and she can add any number up to 10, and to see what we get, and we'll see who gets to 100. So 1. 12. 23, 34, 35, 46, 57, 78, 89. 100, I win. But thank you very much, Anna. Poor Anna, but of course everything was rigged against her. How did I do it? Yes? Sorry? I went first, which obviously helped, yes? And what else happened? Whenever Anna came up with a number, like 6, I would then choose 11 minus it. So if you choose 6, I choose 5. If you choose 9, I choose 2. So my sequence is 1, And 12, 23, 34, 45, 56, 67, 78, 89, and 100. So I'm bound to win, which is why I never play that game more than once. Now, here's another one you might like to try. And we'll try it again in a minute, but you might like to try it on your bit of paper. So the idea is to choose any number, and then to reverse it, and then subtract the smaller number from the larger. So let's have a go at this. Would someone like to give me a number, say 3 or 4 digits? Yes? Yes? 1,234. Okay, you're going to have to help me with the subtraction. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, I now reverse this. 4, 3, 2, 1. And I put the larger one above the smaller one. This is the difficult part, so please all check my subtraction. So I have a 7 here. Okay, and then I have 8, is that correct? And then I have a 0. And then I have a 2. Okay? So I hope you've all done that with 3. Okay. Well, just to tell you whether you're wide awake. And I'm glad you are. Okay, so I hope you've all done that with your own numbers. And now the next thing is I'm going to cross out a number. And so supposing I cross out this one, and then I add up the other digits, and that gives me 10. And if the answer is 10, then I know which digit was crossed out. As we'll see. So if you'd like to try that with different numbers, and then I'm going to ask for some of your responses. So first of all, write down a number, say 3 or 4 digits, 5 digits if you like, if you're feeling strong. Reverse it. Then subtract the smaller one from the larger one. I'd now like you to select any digit other than 0 and remove it. And tell me the sum of the remaining digits. And the idea is that I will then tell you which number you removed. So anyone got any answers?
17.
The calculation again, I think you'll find it's 1. Yes?
9.
So you removed a 9?
Yes.
Yes? Anyone else? Yes? 12, you removed a 6.
18.
You removed a 9. Yes? Any others? How did I do it? Basically, the thing is that if you take a number and reverse it and subtract, the answer you get is always divisible by 9. It always has 9 as a factor. That's not difficult to prove. I'll let you have a go at that. The other thing about it, if you have a number divisible by 9 and add up all the digits, then you'll get a multiple of 9. So if you remove a digit, I know which one you've removed because I just go up to the next multiple of 9. So if you have 14, you must have removed a 4 because the total of the sum of the digits would be 18. If you have 17, you must have removed a 1. If you have 9, you can't have removed a 0 because that wasn't allowed, so you must have removed a 9. So you might like to try that on your friends. And the result is that you'll lose your friends, but it's quite a nice little trip. It was around this time that I took up the hobby of photography using the new collodion process. I was one of the first to regard photography as an art rather than as just a means of recording images. And I'm known as a pioneering photographer who took some 3,000 pictures of my Oxford contemporaries, famous figures of the time, such as the scientist Michael Faraday and the poet laureate Alfred Lord Tennyson, and many pictures of children.
I and my sisters used to love spending the afternoon with Mr. Dodgson, watching him mix his chemicals, dressing up in costumes, and posing quite still for many seconds until the picture emerged. This picture of me, dressed as a beggar girl, was described by Alfred Tennyson as the most beautiful photograph he'd ever seen.
Around this time, I also started my popular writing. My pen name of Lewis Carroll, which I used when writing for children, derived from my real name, Lewis, That's a form of Ludwig, my middle name and my mother's maiden name, while Carol, or Carolus, is the Latin for Charles. In 1857, I wrote a parody of Hiawatha, Longfellow's lengthy poem of 2 years earlier, but in my case, concerning a highly dysfunctional family who couldn't sit still while being photographed. Here's the beginning.
From his shoulder, Hiawatha took the camera of rosewood, made of sliding, folding rosewood, nearly put it all together. In its case, it lay compactly, folded into nearly nothing. But it opened out the hinges, pushed and pulled the joints and hinges till it looked all squares and oblongs like a complicated figure in the second book of Euclid.
And talking of Euclid leads me now to my great enthusiasm for geometry, a subject I spent much of my time teaching to students for the Oxford examinations. Do you recall the famous Pythagorean theorem on right-angled triangles? The area of the square on the hypotenuse, that's the longest side, is equal to the sum of the areas of the squares on the other two sides. Or in algebraic terms, which of course the Pythagoreans wouldn't have understood, a squared plus b squared is equal to c squared. Here's what I wrote about it sometime later in the middle of an otherwise serious treatise on Euclid's parallel postulate. It is as dazzlingly beautiful now as it was in the day when Pythagoras first discovered it and celebrated the event, it is said, by sacrificing a hecatomb of oxen, that's 100 oxen. A method of doing honor to science that has always seemed to be slightly exaggerated and uncalled for. One can imagine oneself, even in these degenerate days, marking the epoch of some brilliant scientific discovery by inviting a convivial friend or two to join one in a beefsteak and a bottle of wine. But a hecatomb of oxen, it would produce a quite inconvenient supply of beef. But the Greek geometer I was most involved with was not Pythagoras, but Euclid, who probably lived around 250 BC or so. His most famous work, The Elements, is claimed to be the most printed book after the Bible, and it consists of 13 books on geometry and arithmetic and is logically organized, starting with some basic axioms, then some simple deductions, then further ones, until a massive hierarchy of results has been produced. Regarded as excellent training for the mind, it was used for teaching for some 2,000 years, particularly in Victorian times, with over 200 editions appearing in England alone in the 19th century. I've always been a great enthusiast for The Elements, knowing it intimately and having to teach it for the Oxford examinations, although there were rival texts, as we'll see. Here's a drawing I once made, which shows the hierarchical structure of book one of The Elements, starting at the top with axioms and then some elementary results and then some harder results, leading eventually to proposition 47, which happens to be a proof of the Pythagorean theorem. But in geometry, I'm probably best known for my book Euclid and His Modern Rivals, which appeared in 1879. A movement was being launched at the time to replace Euclid in schools by newly devised geometry texts. I've always been bitterly opposed to these aims, and my book, dedicated to the memory of Euclid, is a detailed attempt to compare Euclid's Elements, favorably in every case, with geometry texts by various authors of the time. To make it more popular, it's written as a drama in four acts with four characters. First are Minos and Rhadamanthus, who were two of the judges at the entrance to Hades, here recast as Oxford examiners with a whole pile of mathematics papers to mark. Along comes Herr Niemand, who's another German professor, and also Euclid himself. And between them, they manage to demolish each rival book in turn, leaving, of course, Euclid as the only option. Meanwhile, my love of geometry also surfaced in some unexpected places. My dynamics of a party call, and notice the word party, was a whimsical political pamphlet issued for the election for the Oxford University parliamentary seat. And I started with some definitions parodying those of Euclid. So where Euclid had said,
a plane angle is the inclination of two straight lines to one another, who meet together, but which are not in the same direction.
So I asserted, plane anger is the inclination of two voters to one another who meet together, but whose views are not in the same direction. And where Euclid had said,
when a line, meeting another line, makes the angles on one side equal to those on the other, the angle on each side is called a right angle.
My version is, when a proctor, that's a university administrator, meeting another proctor, makes the votes on one side equal to those on the other, the feeling entertained by each side is called right anger. And I concluded that obtuse anger is that which is greater than right anger. And so I went on for several pages, leading to the following mock geometrical construction.
Let UNIV be a large circle, and take a triangle, two of whose sides, WEG and WH, are in contact with the circle, while GH, the base, is not in contact with it. It is required to destroy the contact of WEG and to bring GH into contact itself. Instead,
here, UNIV is the university. WEG is a sitting candidate, William Ewart Gladstone, who later became prime minister, but who was far too liberal for my tastes. GH is Gaythorne Hardy, who was my preferred choice, and WH is William Heathcote, the third candidate. The aim of the theorem is to unseat Gladstone and replace him in Parliament by Gaythorne Hardy. And I concluded, when this is effective, it will be found most convenient to project WEG to infinity. I was an inveterate letter writer. In over 30 years, I sent and received tens of thousands of letters, cataloguing them all. Although many of my letters were to my brothers and sisters or to distinguished figures of the time, my most interesting ones were to my child friends. I've always had a deep understanding of their minds and an appreciation of their interests, qualities that stemmed from my own happy childhood experiences with my brothers and sisters. Some of my letters contain poems, puzzles, and word games, such as this one I wrote to my friend Ina Watson. So let's read this together. So it starts, it's sent from the chestnuts. The chestnuts, which I'll visit later on, you'll see what that means then. So it starts, my dear Ina, though I don't give birthday presents, still I may write a birthday card, and so on. And here's a mathematical letter I wrote to a young lad of 14 called Wilton Ricks. Honored sir, understanding you to be a distinguished algebraist, that is distinguished from other algebraists by different face, different height, etc., I beg to submit to you a difficulty which distresses me much.
If x and y are each equal to 1, it is plain that 2 times x squared minus y squared equals 0. And also that 5 times x minus y equals 0. Hence, 2 times x squared minus y squared equals 5 times x minus y. Now, divide each side of this equation by x minus y. Then, 2 times x plus y equals 5. But x plus y equals 1 plus 1, which is 2. So 2 times 2 equals 5.
Ever since this painful fact has been forced upon me, I have not slept more than 8 hours a night, and I have not been able to eat more than 3 meals a day. I trust you will pity me and kindly explain the difficulty to your obliged Lewis Carroll. So where's the error? I've divided by x minus y, which is 0, and you're not allowed to divide by 0. Well, okay.
Mr. Dodgson used to take me and my sisters on educational tours of Oxford. He also took us on boating trips, such as the famous excursion in July 1862, when he told us the famous story of Alice's Adventures Underground, as he originally called it.
There's an interesting mathematical puzzle to be found in this book. After falling down the rabbit hole at the beginning of the book, she's rather confused.
I'll try if I know all the things I used to know. Let me see. 4 times 5 is 12, and 4 times 6 is 13, and 4 times 7 is, oh dear, I shall never get to 20 at that rate.
So what's that all about? Well, it's been interpreted as a problem in using different number bases. In our usual base 10 number system, where we package numbers in tens, 9 plus 5 equals 14, which is, of course, 1 lot of 10 plus 4. But in base 12, where we package numbers in 12s, such as when we use feet and inches, 9 inches plus 5 inches equals 14 inches, which is 1 foot 2 inches, which we can now call 1, 2. So here are some calculations in different bases. In base 18, 4 times 5 is 1 lot of 18 plus 2, so that's 1, 2. In base 21, 4 times 6 is 1 lot of 21 plus 3, giving 1, 3. So as Alice said, 4 times 5 is 12, and 4 times 6 is 13. So let's carry on like this, increasing the base by 3 each time. And we eventually reach 4 times 12 is 19 in base 39. But then things go wrong. In the next base, 42, 4 times 13 is 1 lot of 42 plus 10. So that's 1x, where x represents 10. What we don't get is 20, because then in base 42, that gives you 2 42s, which is 84. So Alice was right. She never did get to 20. Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, as it was eventually called, proved to be a magnificent success. And in later years, the story went around, which I firmly denied, that Queen Victoria had been utterly charmed by it.
Send me the next book Mr. Carroll produces.
The next book being an elementary treatise on determinants with their application to simultaneous linear equations and algebraical geometry.
We are not amused.
Unfortunately, my book on determinants was not a great success, even though it included the first appearance in print of a result that later became well known. People said that my terminology was too awkward. But what are these determinants? And how can they be used to solve simultaneous linear equations? Let's just quickly look at that. So the determinant of four numbers A, B, C, D, which you can see at the top, is simply the number A times D minus B times C. That's AD minus BC. So for example, on the left, the determinant of 2, 1, 1, 2 is 2 times 2 minus 1 times 1, which is 3. In the middle, the determinant of 5, 1, 4, 2 is 5 times 2 minus 1 times 4, which is 6. And then of 2, 5, 1, 4 is 8 minus 5, which is 3. What does this represent? It represents an area. For example, the area of the diamond shape defined by 2, 1 and 1, 2 is 3, agreeing with the answer on the left. Suppose we now want to solve these two simultaneous equations below. We can either do it by the way you learnt at school, or you can draw two lines on a graph and find out where they cross each other. Or without going into details, we can write down some determinants involving these numbers, 2, 1, 1, 2, 5, and 4. I've used the results we had at the top, and if you do those calculations there, you then get the same answers as before. So that's how you use these determinants to solve these equations. But this procedure can be difficult when you have larger sets of equations with more unknowns, and so I invented a method called the condensation method, which reduces any equations, like the ones at the top here, to the calculation of 2 by 2 determinants only, which we do know how to calculate, as we've seen. Don't worry about the details. The point is that my method actually caused some interest and was presented on my behalf by Pat Price at a meeting of the Royal Society. Very sadly, in 1868, my father died, and I suddenly had to find a new home for my 7 unmarried sisters, shown on the right in a photograph I once took across rectory. And if you go to Guildford in Surrey, you can still see the house called the Chestnuts. Meanwhile, at Christchurch, I was fortunate to acquire a wonderful suite of 10 rooms. Here's my living room. And the tiles around the fire screen were designed by the well-known artist William de Morgan, son of the mathematician Augustus de Morgan. The college had just elected a governing body instead of being run by the Christchurch canons, and I now find myself voting on various issues, such as appointments to academic posts and the choice of a college architect. I soon developed an interest in the study of voting patterns and constructed several examples to show the failure of several conventional methods. So here's my example to show the unfairness of the simple majority or first past the post system.
Let us suppose that there are 11 voters and 4 candidates, A, B, C, D, and that each voter has arranged the candidates in a column in order of preference.
So the first voter on the left, reading downwards, has ranked them in the order A, C, D, B, and so has the second and third. The next 4 have ranked the candidates as B, A, C, D, and so on. Which candidate overall is best? Well, you can see that candidate A is considered best by 3 voters, and second best by all the remaining 8. In my view, A should have won. But in spite of this, candidate B is selected as the winner, even though he's ranked worst by over half of the voters. Some of my recommendations were adopted in England, such as the rule that allows no results to be announced until all the voting booths have closed. Others, such as my proposed methods of proportional representation, were not. But as the philosopher Sir Michael Dummett, himself an expert on voting, later remarked,
"It's a matter of the deepest regret that Dodgson never completed the book that he planned to write on the subject. Such were the lucidity of his exposition and mastery of the topic that it seems possible that, had he ever published it, the political history of Britain would have been significantly different."
I was also concerned about the fairness of tennis tournaments at a time when there was then no seeding. I was concerned that a player who had been beaten was mortified to see the second prize awarded to a player quite inferior to himself. Here's an example with 8 players, ranked in order. Player 1 is the best, and 8 is the worst. After the first set of games, 1 beats 2, 3 beats 4, and so on. So 1, 3, 5, and 7 survive to the second round. 1 and 5 then go on to the next round, and player 1 justly wins. But the second prize unfairly goes to player 5, who started in the lower half of the ranking. This worried me, so I came up, after some thought, with a scheme whereby the top three prizes are actually awarded to the best three players. Let's turn to something a little more lighthearted now, some of the puzzles I enjoyed showing to adults and to my young child friends. I wrote a puzzle book, A Tangled Tale, which contains 10 stories, each involving challenging mathematical problems. And I'm going to show you its preface, and I want you to tell me which of my child friends it was dedicated to.
Beloved pupil tamed by thee, addition, subtract, multiplication, division, fractions, rule of three, attest thy deft manipulation. Then onward, let the voice of fame from age to age repeat thy story, till thou hast won thyself a name, exceeding even Euclid's glory.
So who is it dedicated to? It's quite easy. Look at it again. If you look at the second letter of each line, it spells out Edith Ricks. She was the sister of Wilton Ricks, to whom I wrote the algebra letter earlier. So let me show you some puzzles. So first of all, I'm going to hand an envelope to someone. Would someone like to take this? Yes, thank you very much. Don't open it yet. I'm sure that many of you will know this problem, which I was very, very fond of. Okay, so I want to have a volunteer to give me a three-digit number. Yes? 123, okay. I'm now going to reverse that. That's 321. And I'm going to subtract the smaller from the larger. Let's hope I get it right this time, but you're there to tell me if I don't. So the first, is that 8? Okay, carry 1, and there's a 9, and then there's a 1. Okay? I now reverse this. And I add. Okay, 9 plus 9 is 8, 8 plus 1. Now, we haven't met before, have we? And I didn't know what number you were going to call out. Would you like to open the envelope? I'd like to read out the number on the card. Well, I only do this trick once. Because you start with any number, three-digit number, and reverse it, subtract, reverse, and add, you always get 1,089. The only thing is that when you the number you start with, the first and last digits must differ by more than one for it to work. But here's something for you to work on when you get home. See if you can explain why this works. Now, this particular problem was quite well known, but what I did was to do a similar idea for pounds, shillings, and pence. Now, in England, in the Victorian times, we're very happy using pounds, shillings, and pence, knowing that there are 12 pennies in a shilling and 20 shillings in a pound. So we can do the same sort of thing. You write down a sum of number, a sum of money, you reverse it, and you subtract. 5 minus 9, so you've got to borrow 12 pence, so that's 17 minus 9, that's 8 pence. And then it's 16 minus 16, you've carried one, so it's 19 shillings, and you've got one more, and you subtract and you get that. Follow that? Now you reverse that and add, and whatever you start with, you always end up with 12 pounds, 18 shillings, and 11 pence. And you might like to try and work out why that's true as well. Oh, and incidentally, the one on the left, you might like to see if you can see what happens if instead of doing three-digit numbers, you start with four-digit numbers. Does the same thing happen? What is the magic answer at the end? Here's another favorite of mine. It's a geometry problem. Let's start with a grid, an 8x8 grid of 64 squares, and cut it into four pieces. I've done that, and I've rearranged those four pieces below. So you can see each of the four pieces at the top is repeated down below. What's the area of the figure down below? It's 5x13, which is 65 squares. Where has the extra square come from? Any idea? Sorry? That's right. If you look at that diagonal, in fact, it's a very, very long, thin, diamond-shaped hole whose area is exactly equal to one square. But I enjoyed showing that puzzle to my friends, my child friends, and my adult friends. And you notice that the numbers coming in here, 5, 8, and 13, are consecutive Fibonacci numbers, for those who have come across those. And in fact, you can play this trick with any three consecutive Fibonacci numbers, and in each case, you either gain or lose a square. Here's a different sort of problem called brandy and water.
Take two glasses, one containing 50 spoonfuls of brandy, and the other containing 50 spoonfuls of water. Take one spoonful of brandy from the first glass and transfer it to the second glass. Then take a spoonful of the mixture and transfer it back to the first glass. Has more brandy been transferred from the first glass to the second, or more water from the second back to the first?
Who thinks the former? Who thinks more brandy has been transferred from the first glass to the second? Okay, who thinks more water has been transferred from the second glass to the first? Who doesn't think? Who doesn't care? Well, actually, the answer is they're exactly the same. Somewhat surprising, perhaps. You can certainly check this by doing the calculations, but a much quicker way is to notice that at the end, you've transferred a spoon of liquid and another spoon of liquid back again. Each glass ends up with 50 spoonfuls of liquid. So since each glass ends up with the same amount of liquid, the amount of water in the first one must equal the amount of brandy in the second one. I always enjoyed that particular puzzle. Another famous problem, hotly debated in various Oxford Common Rooms, is my monkey puzzle.
A rope goes over a pulley. On one side is a monkey, and on the other side is an equal weight. The monkey starts to climb the rope. What happens to the weight?
Some of my colleagues thought that it went up, while others said that it went down. What do you think? Who thinks it goes up? Who thinks it goes down? Okay, most people haven't an idea. In fact, it moves up in such a way that the monkey and the weight always remain at the same level. Let's come now to my last topic for today, mathematical logic. Throughout my life, I've been interested in the subject, and there are many logical allusions in the Alice books. In Through the Looking Glass, Tweedledum and Tweedledee are bickering as always.
I know what you're thinking about, but it isn't so, nohow.
Contrariwise. If it was so, it might be. And if it were so, it would be. But as it isn't, it ain't. That's logic. I truly believe that symbolic logic can be understood by my many child friends, and so I've devised the game of logic to help them sort out syllogisms. So what are syllogisms? Dating back to Aristotle, they're pairs of statements, called premises, that lead to a conclusion. For example, if we know that all men are mortal and Socrates is a man, we can deduce that Socrates is mortal. Mine are more entertaining. For example,
no bald creature needs a hairbrush.
No lizards have hair.
Conclusion, no lizard needs a hairbrush.
My methods for finding these conclusions uses a board with 9 red and gray counters that are placed on sections of it to represent true and false statements. Here's another example which opens my book on symbolic logic. If we know that...
That story of yours about your once meeting the sea serpent always sets me off yawning.
And that...
I never yawn, unless when I'm listening to something totally devoid of interest.
You can conclude that...
That story of yours about your once meeting the sea serpent is totally devoid of interest.
If, dear reader, you will faithfully observe these rules and so give my book a really fair trial, I promise you most confidently that you will find symbolic logic to be one of the most, if not the most, fascinating of mental recreations. I taught most of its contents to children and have found many of them to take a real intelligent interest in the subject. My later logical puzzles involve more than two premises. One or two are straightforward, such as this one. What can we deduce if we know the following?
Babies are illogical.
Nobody is despised who can manage a crocodile.
Illogical persons are despised.
So what can we deduce? The first and third statements, babies are illogical and illogical persons are despised, tell us that babies are despised. And since nobody is despised who can manage a crocodile, we can deduce that...
Babies cannot manage crocodiles.
Others needed more thought, but can be sorted out with my counters. This one has five premises.
No kitten that loves fish is unteachable.
No kitten without a tail will play with a gorilla.
Kittens with whiskers always love fish.
No teachable kitten has green eyes.
No kittens have tails unless they have whiskers.
So what can you deduce from that? Well, if you use my counters, you can then conclude that...
No kitten with green eyes will play with a gorilla.
But we don't need to stick to just five premises. The most ingenious of my examples go up to 40 and 50 premises. But the last problem I want to look at today is not like this. It's a geometrical one, which I stayed up to 4 a.m. one night trying to solve. Can you find three right-angled triangles with whole number sides and all having the same areas? Well, I tried, and I managed to find two of them, shown here, with common area 210. But I couldn't find a third. But in fact, as I learned later, the smallest possible solution is as shown below, with common area 840. But interestingly, the first two of them have sides that are exactly twice the length that I myself managed to find.
But at the end of 1897, Charles Dodgson went to the Chestnuts in Guildford to spend Christmas with the family, intending to finish volume two of his Symbolic Logic, but he caught pneumonia. He died just before its completion, and his manuscript version didn't turn up until the 1970s. If it had appeared on time, then he might have been recognized as one of the greatest British logicians of his time. Here's his posthumous portrait in Christ Church Hall, together with two of the stained glass windows in Darsbury Church, where he was baptized. Coincidentally, Dean Little, whose daughter Alice had been so much a part of Dodgson's life, died just 4 days later. Here's part of their joint eulogy in Christ Church Cathedral.
Within the last few days, Christ Church has lost much. And though the work that bore the fame of Lewis Carroll far and wide stands in distant contrast with the Dean's, still it has no rival in its own wonderful and happy sphere. And in a world where many of us laugh too seldom, and many of us laugh amiss, we all owe much to one whose brilliance and incalculable humor found us fresh springs of clear and wholesome and unfailing laughter.
But let's conclude with some words of Lewis Carroll himself. While sitting in his room during a noisy Christchurch ball in 1857, he designed a double acrostic, one of whose verses has sometimes been taken to be his autobiography.
Yet what are all such gaieties to me, whose thoughts are full of indices and surds? X squared plus 7x plus 53 equals 11 thirds. Thank you for your attention.
Well, I dare say this is about the only chance you'll ever have to ask a question of the inimitable Lewis Carroll. So if you do have a question, please raise your hand high. I will come around with the microphone and wait for the microphone to ask your question. So anyone interested, anyone have a question? Ah, I see one right here.
Interested in the example, you had sort of a rhombus shape with the matrices, and the area of that rhombus was 3. So I was just curious, because you only had 2 coordinates labeled. How do you know that that determines the area of that rhombus?
Well, no, it's because it's true, but you have to prove it. So so if you're trying to give a geometrical interpretation of a determinant, that's what it turns out to be, but that's obviously something that you have to prove. Okay. In fact, the answer is either it is the determinant, but sometimes the determinant is negative. So, of course, you can't have negative areas, but you get the right number coming out. But that's something that the mathematicians have to prove. So you have to believe it.
Hi. Can you clarify that problem with the area where you divided? You had some diagonals, and the area changed from 64 to 65.
Yes, as I said, if you take the 4 pieces and rearrange them, it looks as though the diagonal is solid. But in fact, there's a very, very thin diamond shape. If you actually fit them, if you cut them out and do it really accurately, you find it isn't quite, they don't quite fit. There's a little tiny hole in the middle. And that hole has an area of one. And so that's where the missing one comes from. Thank you for asking.
Was the book on logics found in the 70s published? And could you comment a little more about his thought regarding logic?
Yes, what actually happened, as I say, he published volume 1. Volume 2, he had sent a lot of the pages already to the press. In those days, you didn't finish the whole book and then send it to the Oxford University Press or Macmillan's or whoever. So he sent things a bit at a time. So quite a lot of the book had been available, but I think his family was told that if he ever died, they should destroy any unpublished manuscripts. And so there were none available. But it was in about 80 years later, 70 years later, that in fact one of the proof copies was actually found in the descendants of someone that he knew in Oxford, and so an American logician called Bartley managed to republish all of these things in book form. So there is a book which does now contain all of the available things from there. As to his role as a logician, the particularly important ones, he had 2 logical paradoxes, 2 logical puzzles. One was the problem of the barber, which came out in the 1890s. But the really well-known one was called Achilles and the Tortoise, not the old Greek problem of Zeno. But there's a problem. It's written as one of these jolly Lewis Carroll-type stories. That's why I write it that way. But if you read it, it's not only interesting in geometry from a Euclidean geometry point of view, but it's also interesting because it has all sorts of a very interesting logical idea, which really caught the imagination of a logician. Certainly Bertrand Russell later was very impressed with both of those paradoxes. And so this is why, as I say, I have sometimes been described as the greatest logician between, say, George Boole and Bertrand Russell. In fact, in my friend Robin Wilson told me that he spoke to the professor of logic in Oxford, who said that
from his point of view, the two most important logical paradoxes and much discussed logical paradoxes are the so-called Russell paradox, which I won't go into today, and Dodgson, my one of Achilles.
Okay, on that note, please join me in thanking one more time Mr. Charles Robin Lutwidge Wilson Dodgson.